Chronicle Books presents Julia Morgan, an intimate biography of the trailblazing architect, written by Victoria Kastner, read by Cindy Kay, with an introduction by the author.
Introduction. During the past several years, both critical and popular regard for Julia Morgan and her architecture has skyrocketed. One reason for this expanding interest? The American Institute of Architects' decision to posthumously award her their highest honor, the Gold Medal, as their first ever female recipient. No longer is she associated solely with Hearst Castle at San Simeon, the vast and glamorous country house she designed for William Randolph Hearst in the 1920s and 1930s. Julia Morgan is now justly celebrated for her work in its entirety. Over the first half of the 20th century, she designed an estimated 700 structures throughout the western United States. They vary widely in purpose: schools, churches, office buildings, clubhouses, hospitals, stores, modest family dwellings, and grandly opulent estates, as well as in architectural style. In the 1960s and 1970s, when modernism was in its ascendancy, critics either ignored her or derided her for not having adopted one signature style of her own. Today, she is acclaimed for her skill in employing disparate styles and for her steadfast commitment to creating buildings that met the needs of each individual client. Julia Morgan's designs are all alike in one way, large or small. They exemplify the three characteristics propounded by the ancient Roman architect Marcus Vitruvius: firmitas, strength; utilitas, functionality; and venustas, beauty. In spite of her widening renown, some misconceptions about Julia still linger. One enduring myth holds that she burned her papers before closing her San Francisco office in 1950. Perhaps this legend derives from her having asked former clients if they would like to keep the drawings and blueprints that she no longer had sufficient space to store. In fact, Julia personally preserved an enormous amount of material, including hundreds of letters from her family, staff, and friends, more than 2,000 letters that she exchanged with Hearst over 30 years, school notes and sketchbooks from her studies at the École des Beaux-Arts in Paris, and the half-dozen diaries she kept on her travels. These last items are perhaps the most remarkable, since they alternate between mundane record-keeping and surprisingly personal disclosures, and since they have been so rarely read or quoted by scholars. Julia's papers are located primarily in the Robert E. Kennedy Library's Special Collections and Archives at California Polytechnic State University in San Luis Obispo. There are also significant holdings, including invaluable interviews with her family, friends, and employees, at the University of California's Bancroft Library and its College of Environmental Design in Berkeley, as well as in the archives at Hearst Castle. Another durable misconception concerns Julia's private life. Many have wondered whether she remained unmarried because she was a lesbian. Abundant historical evidence confirms that she had no romantic relationships of any kind. Though she cultivated many warm friendships with her clients and her staff, Julia's lifelong love affair was with architecture. She once offered this reasoning when declining a request to visit long-distance friends: "Thank you for your invitation, which sounded so pleasant. One trouble about an architect's work is that there is never a period when things do not overlap, and to get any real time away, it means the closing of one's office." Her nephew, Morgan North, and his wife, Flora, knew her best. He explained, "I don't think she ever got close to marriage. I don't think the subject ever entered her head, really." Flora continued, "I think she found immediate interest in her career because she pursued it 24 hours a day thoroughly. When she was with you, it was full focus, but the rest of the time, her attention was on her architecture." When Julia died at age 85 in 1957, Morgan North served as the executor of her estate. He and Flora carefully preserved her archives and protected her legacy. In the 1970s, not long before his death, he also recorded a message to the historian. He was worried that authors of the time seemed to be focusing on Julia's architecture, but not on Julia herself. Her personal background is going on concurrently with the business background, he explained. He stated that no author thus far had described what Miss Morgan was, or what she really did, or what she was trying to do, or why. Without addressing these motivations, he continued, no book would be complete. He concluded by saying that if a biographer sticks with it long enough, they will eventually develop insight. This book is described as an intimate biography because it is the first volume to thoroughly examine Julia's private life as well as her career. In Morgan North's phrasing, I have stuck with it. During the decades I spent as the official historian at Hearst Castle, I developed a deep knowledge of Julia Morgan and William Randolph Hearst's inimitable architect-client relationship. I was already very familiar with her environs, having, like her, grown up in the San Francisco Bay Area. I spent many years reviewing her papers, exploring her buildings, and studying her drawings. In short, I have developed the insight and knowledge necessary to reveal the woman behind the architecture as a complex individual, as well as a brilliant artist. Perhaps the one word that best describes Julia Morgan is strength. This might seem odd, considering her diminutive appearance, but her strength helped her conquer endless difficulties. Stubborn misogynists, family troubles, personal health struggles, demanding clients, and more logistical and construction challenges than we can possibly guess. She led a passionate life, albeit one that was devoted to creativity rather than to romantic love. She believed in herself and in her ability to solve problems, and this was the secret of her greatness. She gave her all, invariably with determination and often with joy. When she was about to return to San Simeon after a long illness, her first missive to Hearst concluded, "It is a great pleasure to be able to play at work again." The story of Julia Morgan's inspiring life will encourage us to do the same.
Chapter 1. Glimpsing the Future. In the spring of 1919, when Julia Morgan first visited San Simeon, she saw a quiet shoreline bordered by rolling hills. She didn't realize she was looking at the site that would preoccupy her for nearly 30 years. It was a time of new beginnings. World War I had ended, and America was on the brink of the Roaring Twenties, a decade of unparalleled prosperity. Julia had traveled to San Simeon at the invitation of William Randolph Hearst, a prominent press lord whom she knew well. His mother, Phoebe Apperson Hearst, had introduced them 15 years before, and Julia had already designed three projects for him: a lavish estate in Sausalito, north of San Francisco, which was never built, a modest cabin on the south rim of the Grand Canyon, and a large mission-style headquarters for one of his newspapers, the Los Angeles Examiner. Earlier that week, W.R., as Hearst was known, had walked into Julia's office at the end of the day. Years later, her longtime employee Walter Steilberg related the conversation he'd overheard. "I was at my table after 5 o'clock. I often worked late because it was interesting work, whatever it was. I heard this voice, which I had heard before, but I didn't realize what a high-pitch Mr. Hearst's voice had. For such a large man, it seemed to me his pitch was very high, so it carried. I heard him say to Miss Morgan, 'I would like to build something up on the hill at San Simeon. I get tired of going up there and camping in tents. I'm getting a little old for that. I'd like to get something that would be more comfortable. The other day, I was in Los Angeles, prowling around secondhand bookstores, as I often do, and I came upon this stack of books called bungalow books. Among them, I saw one which has a picture. This isn't what I want, but it gives you an idea of my thought about the thing, keeping it simple, of a Japo-Swiss bungalow.' He laughed at that, and so did she." A simple project, W.R. promised. It would take her less than 6 months from start to finish. A few days later, therefore, Julia boarded a train for the 8-hour overnight journey to San Simeon, the first of what would become her nearly 600 trips. When her train pulled into the San Luis Obispo station just before sunrise, W.R. was waiting. He led her to a black Model T Ford idling nearby. It was driven by young Steve Zagar,
who would eventually amass a fleet of taxis for driving Hearst's guests the additional 40 miles north to San Simeon. They climbed into Steve's Tin Lizzie, as these cars were affectionately known, when he eased onto the narrow, bumpy highway. W.R. and Julia never had a romance, but they were old friends. They had much in common, including a passion for European art and architecture. Though a casual observer.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.